Good morning, everyone. We have a few announcements this morning, so bear with me. First of all, we'd like to welcome all of our members here this morning, and a special welcome to all of our guests. We're happy everyone's here this morning. We have a complete list of those that are having health issues or struggling in our bulletin, so pick one of those up, but there's a few names we're going to mention here this morning. Roger Hall, Brooks Craven's boss, had a bypass surgery and is in need of prayers as he recovers. Heather Roush, Brandon Wood's sister, is having some health issues and is requesting prayers. She attends at Greensboro Road, so let's remember those folks. Pat Slaughter's father passed away. Please pray for her and her family. And Rick Thomas is requesting prayers just with some ongoing health issues. Join us this Wednesday for our singing night. There will be no classes, just singing. If you'd like to help out with VBS, it's not too late to join in on the fun. Contact the Longs. And they also have a list of decorations that are needed, so check the bulletin for those. Mark your calendars for our fifth Sunday contribution on June 30th. Our goal is to pay the billing note down to $1 million by October 26. Prayerfully consider your contributions to accomplish this goal. We will be having our monthly service and devotional on June the 30th at 5 p.m. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer if you want to bring a meal. I think there was a little confusion on that. Some people thought that was tonight, but it's next Sunday. I've got a card here. Want to read? It is from the Blankenships. Marty and I would like to say thanks for all your prayers, the visits in this in the hospital, all the cards and the positive thoughts. We appreciate them all. We know this health stuff has been going on since July of 2023, and y'all have hung in there with me. Hopefully I will be able to come back soon. In Christian love, Marty and Janet Blankenship. Those that are to serve this morning, Hunter Phillips will be leading our singing, opening prayers, Craig Culp. Children's time, Tyler Long. Scripture reading, Donald Braden. Lord's Supper prayer is Ron Shelton. And our closing prayer is Ron Marsh.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you today and give you thanks for the opportunity we have to come as fellow Christians to be able to study from your word, to sing praises, to learn more of how we may be able to spread your word. And Father, we're mindful of those that Bill has mentioned this morning that are sick and in need of our prayers, the ones that are on our prayer list, and we pray that you be with them and the families and the ones that tend to their needs. We especially pray, Father, for those that are taking cancer treatments or in the hospital this time. We pray your blessings upon them. Father, we are so thankful for each member here and for the efforts that this church does. We pray that you would be with us during our VBS, that we can have a successful VBS and have many kids come to this congregation and be able to show Christ through that. And Father, as we continue through this service, we ask your blessings upon it, that everything that is said and done here today is pleasing in your sight, that you are praised and you are worshiped today. Help us as your servants, Father, to be out in this community, to teach your word to others, and pray that you'll bless those efforts. We're so thankful for your Son and for his love, the sacrifice that was made on our behalf. It was through his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Children's time. Come on up, kiddos. For those of you that are visiting with us, this is a special time in our service where we focus on all those that are sixth grade and under and have a special lesson directed towards them. This money that you see them putting in this water jug up here is what we use for their missions. Recently, we've done coat drives. We've done buying presents for foster kids and several other things. Those are just the ones that come to mind. Everybody, come on up and have a seat. Is that everybody? Just about. All right, everybody grab a seat. All right, before we get started today, everybody see Miss John over here? See her on the front row? I'm gonna embarrass her for a second. You see her? Today is Miss Jonna's birthday. I won't tell you how old she is because I'm fond of being married. but today is Miss Jonna's birthday. So before we get started, I want y'all to help me sing happy birthday to her. Can y'all do that for me? Sing as loud and as obnoxious as you can. You know that level you scream at home that mom and dad say stop and go outside? Hit that for me, okay? Ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Miss Jonna. Happy birthday to you. All right. Look, y'all should be ashamed of yourself. You upset the baby. Every one of you should be ashamed. All right. Wow, just throw us under the bus. Come here, Bo. Come here. Hold this. Cuz. Y'all friends, let's see how well y'all trust each other. All right, take this. No, you can't hit him on the head with it. Here. Take these. Don't drive them all the way in. Get them good and started and put them all in there. All right, everybody watch Bo for a second. Bo's going to take these nails and he's going to start them into the wood. Use the hammer. There you go. Lock up. Drive a few of them in it. Well, if he does. There's a few nurses in the audience. It'll be fine. You don't think a nurse will cut it? Okay. You don't trust him? I thought y'all were like best friends. We are, but we just have trust issues. Okay. He's best friends, but sometimes he does bad stuff, in case y'all didn't catch that. Kaylee, you might want to work on this later. They're friends in their own way. I'm not even sure what that means. All right, that's good enough. All right, everybody see what he did? Everybody see the nails? All right, take them out. Don't just throw them in the floor. All right, now what do you see? Holes? Everybody see the holes? Probably about to be a hole in your hand, but we'll deal with that later. All right, so everybody saw what Bo did, right? Everybody saw he took the hammer and he took the nails and he put it into the wood, right? When he took, sit down. When he took those nails out, did that wood become whole again? Or is that wood forever changed? That wood has holes in it forever now, right? Because you can see all the little dents. If I'd had bigger nails, they'd have made bigger holes. But y'all see all the little holes that are in that wood, right? That are from Bo abusing this wonderful piece of wood that didn't do anything to him. The words that we speak are a lot like that. So the words that we say have an impact on everybody. The Bible tells us to be slow to speak and slow to wrath. Because sometimes we say things that we shouldn't say, right? Sometimes we say hurtful things that we shouldn't say. And we can apologize for it and we take that back, right? Like when we call someone a name or something and we say we're sorry. We try to apologize and fix it, but that doesn't make it whole. The words that we say leave an impression, just like the nails left an impression on that wood. So the next time you get heated or you get angry or you get upset, take a second, think about what you're about to say, because it will leave an impression even if you apologize for it. Okay? Can y'all do that for me? All right, let's say a quick prayer and then y'all can go sit down. Excuse me, sorry. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and all the many blessings in it. We ask a special blessing on each of the children up here, as we know that they're the future of your church, and we ask a special blessing on the church and here at Grace Point and the parents that are here as they try their best to raise the kids in a manner that's pleasing unto thee and that will further your kingdom. And we ask a special blessing on all of us as we try to help further your kingdom. And we ask that you forgive us when we fail thee and give us a home in heaven with thee in the end. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior. Stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for till my trophies at last I lay down, I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a so despised by the world as a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left in story above to dark Calvary, so I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown to that old
Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this day, and we're thankful for this privilege and honor we have to assemble around the table and partake of these emblems this morning. We're thankful, Father, for this bread, which represents Christ's body that he shed, that he sacrificed for our benefit. We pray that as we partake of it this morning, that we'll each examine ourselves and do so in a way that's acceptable in your sight. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Continuing our thanks, Heavenly Father, again, we're thankful for this opportunity we have to partake of this cup, the fruit of the vine, which symbolizes to Christians throughout the world the blood of Jesus, which was shed for our sins. And again, we pray that as we partake of it this morning, we will do so in an acceptable way. For it's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen. as we conclude the Lord's Supper this morning, we now have an opportunity to give back to the Lord and to His church. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, again, we're thankful for this day. We're thankful for life and all the blessings of life that are ours to enjoy. We pray now, Father, as we give back a portion to You, we pray that we will do so in a way that would not only bring glory to You, but that these monies would be used effectively and to further the kingdom, not only in our area here, but even throughout the world. And we ask it all in the name of Christ. Amen.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior and my all in all, standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
This will be the psalm before the scripture reading and the sermon. If it's convenient for you, I ask you to stand.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when song
This morning's scripture reading comes from Titus chapter 3, verse 14. And let our people learn to devote themselves to good works so as to help cases of urgent need and not be unfruitful. Please be seated.
Amen. Good morning, church. So good to be with you here today. Hey, I don't know what award I should get, but I've survived a week without my wife, okay? At least a pat on the back, something. Man, we need our women, don't we? Hey, I know I need mine. I'm going to tell her, I missed you. Now go cook me dinner. No. No, I won't say that. She'll be gone again. I think I've got till Thursday or Friday, and they'll be back there at church camp if you didn't know. That's why the room is a little less bright. Jamie's out of here. The girls are out of here. I'm looking forward to them being back. But I'm glad you're here. Today's a great day to be a Christian. Today's a great day to worship God here with a body of believers at Grace Point. We got a lot of members here today, a lot of visitors as well, some for the first time, some like the Ransones. Maybe familiar faces to many of you. Some haven't met them yet. They've been in Harrisburg now, so good to see them. Glad everybody's here today. We've got a lot going on. This Wednesday is singing night. Encourage you to come out to that. I'll be gone speaking at the big town of Burning, Missouri, but you come out and support our men as they lead worship and have singing night this Wednesday. Next Sunday, Lord willing, is our fifth Sunday. We'll have a special contribution that I hope that you're praying about. And then that evening, we'll have our evening worship that Michael Horton's going to do the Devo for, the fellowship meal. Sign up for that. Look forward to that. And then this is our last lesson in our ministry mentorship series. So Lord willing, next Sunday, we'll start a new series looking at Nehemiah and rebuilding the walls. So look forward to that. But we're concluding our series, as I said, of ministry mentorship. Hopefully you turn to Titus 3. In the series, we looked at the letters Paul wrote to Timothy and the letter Paul wrote to Titus as well, as we see beautifully in these letters a relationship that is so powerful that I want us to have relationships like these in our church. This entire time, I've been stressing it. I may not have stressed it enough. So as we conclude the series, I want to give you a job. You see the beauty of what a mentorship can look like in the faith, and I want us to have that today, so you've got two responsibilities. Look for someone to mentor you, and look for someone to mentor. Accept the counsel of someone older or wiser than you so that they can encourage your faith, and then, guys, it's your job now. Intentionally find somebody and say, I would love to help you in your faith. What do you need? I'm not going to hold your hand. I'm not going to babysit you. You have the potential to become a powerful Christian. I can help you do that. Really, try and make a difference in someone's life. That's your job. So if you fail at it, I'm going to come back and be upset at you. Paul, as he mentors Titus here, understood the powerful potential that Titus had. even though these people on the island of Crete that you're ministering to, Titus, even though they're stubborn-headed, even though they're hard to work with, you can affect radical change in their lives through you, through the work that you do. And then once you mentor them, once you guide them as I'm guiding you, they can effectively start changing themselves. And one thing leads to the next. I wrote in the bulletin article, mentors, mentor, mentors. Little tongue twister for you. It's a beautiful circle of life in the Christian faith where I am mentored and my mentor trains me up to mentor other people. Mentors, mentor, mentors. There you go. Titus, you've got to raise people up who are ready to not only change their lives and be better individuals, but to change their church and to change their community. We've got an island of liars. That was the reputation of Crete. No one's good there. Don't trust anything they say. Titus, you've got the chance to change that. We need to get these people ready for every kind of good work. And this suggestion that Paul gives here is really more of a command. It's an imperative. You need to prepare these people to be ready for good works. Not just yourself. It's one thing for you to be ready for good works, and you should be. Individually, that's your charge to accept the call yourself. But then, are you helping others accept the call for good works, that they may be ready for good works? And that's what Paul encourages Titus to do. Let us be ready as vessels of every good work. But let's guide others and mentor others to become the same so that it's not the same three people doing all the good works, but we've got a church, an island of people ready to do every single good work, no matter where or when or who they're dealing with and where they're at. The first thing Paul encourages Titus with is the call to good work. He has to set the standard. He has to issue the challenge. So he does this for Titus, and today he does this for us as well. He instructs Titus to extend this call to other believers as well. Remind them of where they've come from and to where they should be aiming, what they should be doing, the kinds of lives they can be living compared to the kinds of lives they shouldn't be living. And the call to good works here, Paul does it really intentionally, and I want us to accept it intentionally as well. True obedience here that Paul outlines and commands is not merely about following rules. True obedience here is about a heart that is ready for every good work. You can't be a secret Christian. If it were only a list of rules that you have to do, I could lock myself in my house and be a perfect Christian. I followed all the rules. I've not broken any of the rules. But that's not what true obedience is about. You can't hide your faith. Instead, cultivate a heart within yourself that loves others and loves the Lord, and then you'll be ready to do good works wherever you are and whoever you're with. And that's what Paul's command emphasizes. It's not a to-do list that you're passing down to them, Titus. It's a way of life. And that's exactly what he tells them to do. It's a broad spectrum of many different actions that he covers here. He doesn't write an exhaustive list. He just gives some things that they need to expect themselves to do, but it's more about the heart that they cultivate within themselves. Look at the first two verses first. The call to good works here. Remind them, Titus, to be submissive to rulers and authorities. Should we skim over that one, or do we like that one? Or that's part of the call to good works. Be submissive to rulers and authorities. Be obedient to be ready for every good work. You can't be ready for every good work if you're bickering with the rulers and authorities and you're not obedient or submissive. Also, man, he doesn't make it easier. To speak evil of no one and to avoid quarreling, to be gentle and to show perfect courtesy toward all people. What does perfect courtesy look like? Because I've never seen it in the mirror. That's really difficult to do. But you can see here in calling people to good works, to be ready for good works, how Paul calls their hearts. It's not merely about obeying the rulers and authorities. It's not merely about avoiding quarrels. That's the external action. He says, go to the heart of the issue. Cultivate a heart that is ready for good works, a heart that is gentle and submissive and loving and courteous and peaceful, and then you will be ready to serve others. It's the heart that Paul emphasizes here. And he talks about quarrels and slander and controversies and arguments so many times in so many of his letters, because that's the kind of things we do. We quarrel. We bicker. We nip at each other. It's almost a game for some people. It can hurt. And the entire time, do you think that's building each other up? You think that's really benefiting someone? You think you're really mentoring someone when you're slanderous, or when you're setting an example of disobedience, and when you're kicking against the goads of everything and everyone in your life? The call for good works is the call of a good heart. And that's what Paul begins here. And notice as well in the first two verses, this is not a call about being prepared for grand gestures, but rather about cultivating a spirit of kindness and gentleness and love. I'm not calling you now, Paul tells to you, to go to Africa tomorrow, even though that'd be great. Go to Haiti tomorrow. Settle the situation in the Middle East tomorrow. Those are grand gestures. Those are big things. I'm not calling you to go door knocking in your community if we want to localize things, make it a little bit more tangible. Those are great to do, but those won't get done unless you cultivate a spirit and a heart of love and gentleness. Don't excuse yourself by thinking it's merely the grand gestures. That's the only good works I can do, is grand gestures. Cultivate a spirit and a heart of love. That's the importance here that Paul is underscoring for us to see here. And then, once we have the call for good works, we need to understand the motivation for good works. You're told to do something, and now, again, we emphasized last Sunday, if you were here, the power that enables you to do that good something. The motivation for good work. How do I do good work? It's not easy to be good and do good. It's easy to be bad and do bad, or be neutral and do nothing. That's what I would prefer. To do good work means you have to examine things. What needs to be done? What can I do? And then you have to do something about it. It's difficult to do that if you're not motivated by something. And personal, internal motivation only lasts so long. And my supply of that seemingly diminishes as I deal with people more and more. I can't motivate myself to do good work. God, you don't know these people. Of course you can't, Chase. I didn't ask you to. I will motivate you to do these good works. My spirit is in you, son, daughter. It will motivate you to do these good works. And that's exactly what Paul reminds Titus. Titus, take hold of that power that's within you so that you can be motivated to help these people. And then teach them. As they mentor themselves and guide themselves about the motivation that they have at their disposal. And you already know it. The greatest motivator for a life dedicated to faithfulness and good works is the love of God. The love of God is the greatest motivator. And Paul includes in here, as we're about to see, remind them of how they used to be. Remind them of how they used to be slaves to various passions. Fear's a good motivator too. But love is what he emphasizes, because that's what God cares about the most. Look at verses 3 through 7, the motivator for good works. We ourselves, Titus, you, me, Paul, I'm including ourselves. We ourselves were once foolish. We were disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. Absolute sinners. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior. so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Hey, remember when you were a loser? Remember when you didn't know Christ and how depraved you were? And then, do you remember the day when you found his love? You remember the moment that your life changed radically, completely, transforming you from one state of being into another completely, changing the person you were entirely? That power is still here. That which brought you from your sins is still here, motivating you to remain away from them and pushing you toward these good works. That's what Paul emphasizes here. Think not only of your former state, which I think of often, how foolish I was and still am, but think instead, if you want to be motivated to do good work, think of the love of Christ. The mercy and grace that he showed to you, our Lord and Savior appeared, did the thing he did for us that we couldn't do for ourselves. That motivates us. And Paul says, it's not because of anything I've done, not because of anything you've done. Our good works are not done to earn God's love, but to reflect it. We do good work because he did the great work for us. It's not because we were already doing good that God decided, okay, these people receive my mercy and love because they're doing good. He said, I'm going to save them. It's my choice. Their righteousness is filthy rags. They haven't done anything to deserve it, but I love them anyway. And once you understand that and remind yourself of the prison of sin that you used to live in, that should motivate you, driving you forward, not only to do good works yourself, serving others, but encouraging them and mentoring them to do the same with joy and perseverance. And that's where we see Paul's final thoughts. The fruitfulness of good work. And I had Donald read verse 14 intentionally on purpose. And we're going to emphasize that as we read it again. But that's all that's left. Accept the call to good works, be motivated to do those good works, and then watch what happens. Just sit back and see the incredible change that you can affect in the world around you. It's really fun to do for third parties. For Christian mentors, to bring someone up in the faith and then just let them go. Kind of like to crank up the spinner and then just watch it spin and see everywhere it goes and everything it touches. Do good works and then see what happens. I guarantee you, you're going to see some fruit of your good works. You're going to see some results. Titus, there's a lot of people here that need your mentorship. They need your motivation. They need, ultimately, the love of Christ. And it's almost like a domino effect, Titus. I can't wait until you see it. I can't wait until you discover it. And then you can share that with these people here. These good works that Paul writes about are tangible. They literally affect the life that we live in now. So the good works serve as tangible expressions of faith, and they contribute to the well-being of others, fostering a sense of unity and love in the church. It is not a good enough work to say, I wish you well. Jesus writes about that in other places. You would say to someone, be fed and be clothed, never feeding them, never clothing them. I can say to you, I love you. But if I don't demonstrate that, you'll know that I'm lying. It'll never produce good fruit if I don't do good works. And that's what Paul writes about here. These are real, tangible benefits in this life that you can affect now for others. That means, church, you're looking around. You're looking among ourselves. Who can I help? Who can I mentor? Who has a need that I can meet? And then if I am in need of mentoring or assistance, hopefully others are looking for me. And you might have to raise your hand and say, I need some help. And then you can see the fruit of the goodness of others shown to you. And that's the greatest fruit there is. Look at what Paul writes about, verses 8 through 15. This saying is trustworthy, and I want you to insist on these things, so that those who have believed in God may be careful to devote themselves to good works. These things are excellent and profitable for people. But, again, avoid foolish controversies, genealogies, dissensions, and quarrels about the law, for they are unprofitable and worthless, not good works. As for a person who stirs up division, after warning him once and then twice, have nothing more to do with him. Knowing that such a person is warped and sinful, he is self-condemned. And then he writes final instructions and greetings. He concludes the letter. He says, when I send Artemis or Tychius to you, do your best to come to me at Nicopolis, for I decided to spend the winter there. Do your best to send Zenas, the lawyer, and Apollos on their way. See that they lack nothing. Here's verse 14 again. And let our people, you and me now, learn to devote themselves to good works so as to help cases of urgent need and not be unfruitful. All who are with me send greetings to you. Greet those who love us in the faith. Grace be with you all. Maybe the best way to end a letter to someone you love. Grace be with you all. Don't let our people be unfruitful. If the greatest potential for the church is to be fruitful, the worst potential is for us to be unfruitful. If they're not prepared for good works, if they don't have a heart that loves the Lord, that knows exactly what he has done for them, they're not going to do these good works. They're going to be caught in these dissensions, these meaningless controversies. They're going to be bickering and arguing about the law. They're going to consume themselves thinking that they have merit, thinking that they have worth, all the while devoting themselves to useless, unfruitful things. Let our people learn to be different, Paul says. We've got to be better. To be fruitful and not be unfruitful. And as we engage in good works now, today, ourselves, we too can bear witness to the world of God's love and grace. And by doing good works, we can draw others to the faith by our actions. Paul's repeated it, so we've repeated it as well. People can ignore what you say, but it's hard to ignore what you do. And it's a trick. Because you're trying to tell them about your transformation. You're trying to tell them about your heart, and they'll ignore it. But if you show them good works with your hands, externally, outwardly, tangible things that they think they need more than Jesus, start there with those things. That reveals your heart. It shows them. These Christians really do love everybody. The only question is, are you the type of Christian that reveals that truth to them? Because if you're not, you're revealing to them hatred and lies. You're not revealing Christ to them. In fact, you're shutting the church up. You're quieting the voice of truth. You're enslaving us to our negative reputations that others have built about us, that we're nothing but judgmental hypocrites. That's the witness you can show. Either a person of love whose good works are inspired by love, or a judgmental hypocrite. And that really is the key. And that's what I'm trying to learn myself. Sometimes I try and find a loophole. I'll do the good work, but I don't have the good heart. I'll force myself to serve this person, even though I think they don't deserve it. God didn't grade on any kind of scale, but I would assume those actions don't even qualify to be measured. It's not about serving me in a temple. It's not about the mountain that you worship on. It's not about your traditions and your rites and your rituals. It's about your heart. Do you have a heart for good work? Are you ready, wherever you are, at the drop of a hat, to serve in whatever way you can, whoever needs it? If you don't, it's probably because you have a heart issue. And if you have a heart issue, thankfully it can be changed. God tells us, I will give you a new heart. I will rip out your old one if you'll allow me to do that drastic surgery on you. And I'm going to supplant in you a heart after my own heart. It's done for you. The motivation for good work is done for you if you'll just allow him to do it. Look for someone who can guide you through this process, who can mentor you, who can show you, how do I fix the heart within me so that I can find joy in serving the church, in coming to church, in reading my Bible? There are people who have that answer for you. Ultimately, God has the answer for you. Turn to Him. But if you're outside of Christ today, the first step you need to make is one of repentance and an attitude of humility. Recognizing, as Paul encouraged the people on the island of Crete to do, remember how you once were. Remember how it felt to be enslaved by various passions and desires, your sinful self. Get rid of it. You don't like him. You don't like her. Kick him out the door and come to Jesus. You can do that today. You can be saved today and become a Christian today, being baptized today, washing away your sins, so that you can find that motivation, that spark of goodness in your heart, and then you can watch it envelop the rest of your life. Or if you have been saved and you struggle to find that motivation, I'll tell you, this church family motivates me, and I know they can motivate you. If you need to be baptized today, or if you need the prayers of the church, if you need anything at all, please come now while we stand and sing to encourage you.
Tis for you and me, thirsty soul, hear the welcome call. Tis a fountain open for all. I will call upon the Lord.
Father, we give thanks for this day that we've had to come in fellowship with fellow Christians to study that word and sing songs of praises to you. Be with us this next week as we go about our daily lives. Help each of us to stop each morning to turn our minds and our hearts to thee in prayer and through Bible study. More importantly, help each of us to look around us as we go through our daily lives to spread the word of Christ to those who are lost and dying world. Heavenly Father, all the blessings that we enjoy, we give thanks to thee. Watch over us in our daily lives. In Christ's name, amen.